Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Amelia Broom. I'm serving as chair of the Department of Performing Arts at Emerson College, and I'm here to welcome you and thank you for being here at this event for Maureen Shea. Event. Memories. Memorial felt a little heavy, so we're calling it a celebration of the life of Maureen Shea. We're here to honor Maureen. We're here to celebrate and honor her accomplishments, her legacy, her life, who she was and who she is to us personally and to the community at Emerson College. To those of us who knew Maureen, who admired, respected, and cared for Maureen Shea, she was multifaceted, complicated, and deeply human. You could count on her to be honest. She loathed injustice. Maureen loved shy people. She was fierce, a fighter. If she was on your side, you were blessed and assured. And if she wasn't, watch out. You will hear stories, remembrances, recollections about Maureen today, all offering glimpses of who she was from different perspectives. This image keeps coming to me like a jewel. So bright, reflective, hard, resilient, and deep when you take the time to look. Maureen, in this beautiful theater where you spent so many hardworking and creative hours, we honor you. Thank you.
Thank you, Amelia, for welcoming us and for inviting us to join together in celebrating the life of our treasured friend and colleague, Maureen Shea. My name is Rob Sabal. I'm the Dean of the School of the Arts, and I'm honored to be with all of you this afternoon, with Maureen's family and friends, with Myrta, and with so many dear members of the Emerson community. Perhaps it's because of the terrible pandemic, or maybe it's because I've been attending too many memorial services like this one, but I've been reflecting lately on the ritual of the wake, and that term wake and the image that it evokes, the ripples and turbulence on the surface of a pond when a boat passes by. It's what's left behind. Maureen Shea has passed through our lives, and today we try in our inchoate and limited ways to describe how the wave she made transformed us, made us more than who we were. But Maureen did more than touch us individually. Maureen passed through our community and this institution, creating ripples and swells and white caps that have forever changed the shape of this place we know as Emerson College. I met Maureen in 1999. I just started as chair of the Visual Media Arts Department, and Maureen was early in her tenure as the chair of Performing Arts, PA. The college had recently restructured, and the inaugural deans of the School of Communication and the School of the Arts were both in their first year. Maureen invited all of the department chairs to a Saturday convening at her home, And over brunch, we talked about our hopes for our programs, we explored connections, we imagined possibilities, and we discovered shared values. And this simple act of bringing us together built trust and forged relationships. And that was Maureen Shea. But this meetup was also about the political power of the chairs, our ability to make change and our authority to resist it. And arguing about our roles, I remember Maureen's intensity. "Come on," she said, "it's our job to look out for the students and the faculty, you know?" That was Maureen to me, fiercely dedicated to the students, unwavering in her support for the faculty, and a passionate advocate for the transformative value of the arts and an art education. Maureen invited us then, and all of us ever since, to that common purpose. She dedicated decades to the creation of a community built on collaborative practice that would center our students and faculty in creative expression. She was a generous member of this community in ways large and small. When she directed for Emerson Stage, she invited faculty members from across the college to collaborate with her. And as you'll hear later in this program, she collaborated with me, lending her voice and talent to my short film. After the launch of Arts Emerson, while conflict simmered and others counseled opposition, Maureen sought out opportunities to enrich the student experience by connecting Arts Emerson with the PA community. And when her colleagues needed her, she showed up. And I don't just mean she provided service on committees, launching new curricula, or building programs, which she did too many to mention, but that she made sacrifices to help others. When PA Chair Bob Colby was undergoing cancer treatment, I asked Maureen, to take on a number of administrative duties in the department. "I'll do it for Bob," she told me. And when Bob died, and the department faculty, staff, and students looked to Maureen, they looked to Maureen for strength, for guidance, for support, and for stability. She helped this community grieve, and she helped this community heal. And now, my friends, we are left to grieve and heal without the capacious embrace of our dear Maureen. We are left to take what we've learned from her and to fill the absence that her passing has created. And that is how we honor her and the influence that she's had on our lives. As we remember Maureen today, not only do we grieve our loss and celebrate her life, but I would submit that we also commit to living. And not living in any old way, we commit to waking up. Right, to wake, living better, being better, calling forth our better selves. The ripples and waves that Maureen made in our community reverberate in us as we take up what we loved and admired in her and make it ours. May the blessing, may the memory of Maureen Shea be a blessing to each of us today and in the days ahead.
The Shea family would like to thank Emerson College and especially the Department of Performing Arts for today's celebration of Maureen's life. I'm Maureen's older brother, Michael, and was asked to share remembrances of Maureen for today's event. I feel both honored and challenged, for Maureen and I shared over 70 years as siblings. Since Maureen's passing in September, I have thought about many of the experiences we shared growing up as the children of Barbara and Jim Shea, along with our older sister, Kathleen. My sister's longtime partner, Myrta, has told me that one of the things people have remarked to her about most since Maureen's death was her wicked sense of humor. I could not agree more. And I think that Maureen would agree that growing up in our house, a sense of humor was a requirement. Both our parents were the source of intended and unintended laughter. Mom and Dad owned a floor covering business in Worcester, where we lived. Dad did the installations and Mom did the back office piece. One of the jobs that was shared by all was answering the separate business line. There were two challenges involved in this task. One, make sure you wrote down accurate information, and two, and this one was much more difficult, do not be fooled by one of the many voices used by Dad pretending to be a customer. With Mom, we had our own version of Lucille Ball. In addition to being a redhead, Mom was known for getting into some zany situations, like the time she backed the family station wagon into the barn next to the house that served as Dad's store. He was inside at the time. Imagine Dad's surprise as the car bumper broke through the wall. Mom was never afraid to laugh at herself and loved to tell that story and others. She was a wonderful storyteller, as was Maureen. And I think Maureen's love of telling stories through the theater was in part influenced by our mother. I, for one, will especially miss Maureen's legendary stories about the best laid plans gone awry. No one told those better. As we got older, Maureen and I were prone to reminiscing about times growing up where we ended up in trouble with our parents. One favorite involved a glass pane in a door that was broken while my parents were out, as we chased each other around the house. I still blame my older sister, Kathleen, who should have done a better job supervising us. Maureen liked to remind me of one winter ride coming home from high school, where our car got stuck on a hill. Maureen claims that I coerced she and her two friends to get out of the car and push it up the hill. In my defense, I always reminded her that I was the only one with a driver's license, so I had to stay in the warm car. She never accepted my sound rationale. Finally, Maureen liked to tease me about forgetting my wallet at home and having to hit her up for an emergency loan as I tried to impress the woman who would become my wife on our second date. The two of them never let me hear the end of it. As Maureen and I reached our AARP age, 50 for those of you who aren't there yet, we competed each year to find the snarkiest birthday card about being the family favorite or looking like one of our parents to send to each other. Along with that, however, almost always came a call and a rendition of Happy Birthday. On my cell phone right now is the last Happy Birthday song I received from Maureen on my birthday in late July of last year. She noted on the call that she thought she was a little flat. I, on the other hand, think she sounds great. I will miss my sister, but I'm so grateful for having been her brother.
Maureen Shea, what a woman! Just always bursting with brilliance and generosity. I wish I had tapped into more of her brilliance while I could. And I'm a little embarrassed that I tapped into so much of her generosity. I was in my early 30s when I first met Maureen. I was trying to transform our ragtag guerrilla street theater, United Fruit Company, into an actual company, the Theater Offensive. And Maureen was one of a very small handful of theater professionals who put themselves out there for us, who Maureen really proactively reached out to me and said, how can I help? She really put her talent on the line for us. And I have to say, her good reputation as well, because, you know, Maureen was old school in a lot of ways. She was this working class dyke who found her calling very early and really poured herself into it like a zealot. I mean, she was a zealot for theater. But unlike many others of her generation, when she fought her way into her own success, she was passionate about spreading that success around. She was passionate about supporting other women artists, supporting other queer people, supporting people of color and working class people in theater and in the arts. I mean, she was really deeply committed to that. I mean, it seems like maybe like it's no big deal to some people now, but it was. I mean, there were very few people in her position of power who were willing to put themselves in danger to broaden the field. And it was a danger. There were people losing their jobs for doing a little fraction of what Maureen was so bold enough to do. So I have to just say, I'm thinking back on that time, and I'll tell you, having Maureen Shea on your side is like a damn superpower. I mean, oh, and when Maureen and her beloved Mirta would team up, when they would collaborate, what can I say? In my experience, I should say, first of all, that they were always collaborating, whether it was in the playbill, if it said that or not. Those two minds were always at play with each other. But when they teamed up, it was just magic and will always be. Those things will always be there with me. At the theater offensive, we were lucky that Maureen and lots of her colleagues at Emerson would often connect us with some of their terrific students to be interns or even staff people. Many of our staff people came from there. Now, this is going to sound kind of random, but I was thinking about it when I was thinking about Maureen. Once I was deciding between two really great intern candidates to be my intern. They were both from Emerson, and they were really terrific. And I heard myself saying to a colleague, you know, I think I should go with the second one because her imitation of Maureen was better, funnier, you know? I mean, no one left that department without working on their Maureen imitation, right? And that just shows the depth of her character, I think. But more importantly, a seminal experience I had in my life in the theater. My life in the theater. Okay, here's the scene. Maureen was directing an early blocking scene of a new play by a new playwright. Her work had never been produced before. And we were in the room. We were working on a scene that was really important. It was clearly really important to the play. But none of us were quite getting it. And Maureen had dug into that script, right? And she, I mean, the actors were all saying their lines, but they were just words, right? She gave this simple, just blocking direction. I don't remember exactly what it was. Something like just, okay, now walk downstage, lean on that chair while you say your next two lines, hold. Now, when you say your line after that, I want you to slump down into the chair while you're saying it. And I remember looking at the actor and seeing this light bulb go on in their head. And in mine, too, I felt it like, yes, that's what this scene is about. And then the other actors were all like looking down at the scripts and looking up at what was going on. They were so engaged. I was like, yes, we get it. And I looked over at the playwright and she was glowing and she was gazing at Maureen like with so much connection. She clearly felt understood. She felt heard and seen and respected and loved. I mean, I thought she might just rip her clothes off and jump on Maureen for sex right there because it was so beautiful and deep and real, corporeal, right? Like it was in somebody's body now. This thing that she had written was in somebody's body in a way that was, you felt sizzling in the air. You were breathing the air of this play now. And I love Maureen Shea.
I'm Scott Pinckney. I'm a longtime colleague of Maureen's. And Maureen was a force of nature. She was loud and she was brash, intimidating at times, and always fiercely protective of her colleagues and most especially her students. To walk in a room where Maureen was present was to be drawn into the eye of a storm, which was the energy she embodied. I first met Maureen 30 years ago when a mutual friend, Russ, asked me to design a show for Emerson at Brimmer Street. The play was Red Noses, and Maureen was the director. It was a classic Maureen play, edgy and a bit out there, and it depicted a priest who traveled around plague-afflicted villages in the 14th century France with a band of fools called the Flotties. They offered holy assistance, all the while wearing red rubber clown noses. Of course, she embraced both the comedy and the tragedy, pushed us all, herself included, to take chances. For me, it was she wanted footlights. Now, that's not much of a challenge, you would say, footlights, you know. But she staged the play in the round. Footlights in the round. This is nuts, but that's what she did. And she challenged me. And in all the years I was privileged to call Maureen my colleague and friend, she never, ever stopped challenging me. I had the extraordinary opportunity to interact with Maureen on so many levels, artistic colleague, academic colleague, boss, formal teacher, mentor, most importantly, my friend. We collaborated on so many plays, many of them in this lovely theater where we're gathered today. We made art that had meaning, and we loved it. When in 2004 I was asked to fill in for a year teaching lighting design at Emerson while a suitable search could take place for someone to take the position, she became my boss. Obviously, that year became many, in large part because Maureen took me under her wing. Maureen was a master of academic politics and guided me through the labyrinth that is academia. And while at Emerson, I decided to get my master's degree in theater education, and thus Maureen became my formal teacher. I don't think I'll ever forget the experience of taking Maureen's Teaching Shakespeare class. I've never known anyone who had a closer relationship with William Shakespeare. It was as if she and the bard would meet after class or rehearsal and discuss the work over drinks. Her knowledge was just that deep. Maureen was also one of the few people who ever got me to act. There's a reason I've chosen to sit out there at a tech table in the dark and avoid the stage. Acting simply wasn't on my radar. But she managed to get me to perform Puck. No, not perform, but be Puck in that Shakespeare class. And when she was done, I burst into tears because I'd never experienced anything quite like that. Maureen was a master. Throughout it all, we made theater, at first with me as a designer, and then with me as a mentor of student designers. Maureen believed deeply in mentorship, and I and so many others were the beneficiaries of that sublime, selfless giving. As I said, most importantly, Maureen was my friend. It was a friendship that I cherished far beyond all the other hats that she wore in my life. This is not to say that there weren't bumps along the way. We disagreed on occasion. Actually, we fought on occasion. But when we did, it was as siblings fight or disagree, with a foundation of love and respect under it all. We never allowed those moments to underline what was a steadfast relationship, and they were forgotten as soon as they were resolved. Maureen was all about moving forward, and those in her circle were inevitably moved forward with her. And I consider myself to be blessed to have been in that circle for such a long time. One night, after a rehearsal, Maureen and I were sitting and chatting, and someone, I'm not sure which one of us, I don't remember, mentioned a themed party in New York called the Ray Party. That was an annual event in the 1980s. After a few minutes of comparing notes, we realized we'd been at the same party in the same year, and we shared a laugh about how small the world was. Well, it's still small, but now it's just a bit darker without Maureen in it. 2 days after Maureen passed, there was a huge rainstorm. And as I was driving home to the Cape, I saw the most extraordinary double rainbow I've ever seen. It was magnificent. And I pulled into a supermarket parking lot and took a photo of that rainbow to save forever, because I believe it was Maureen, in her spectacular, dramatic way, letting me know that things would be all right. Yes, Maureen, things will be all right, and we'll continue to move forward as you would have wished and expected. I would be lying, though, if I said that you won't be sorely missed. Godspeed, my friend, on to your next adventure. And I don't think I can ever say this phrase again without my heart breaking a little bit. You know? Thank you.
We used to live there. We lived there.
We played there.
We played there.
We made love there.
We sang songs together.
We grew up there.
We discovered things.
We dug the earth. We planted seeds.
We harvested.
We regretted being there. We couldn't wait to get out of there.
We hammered nails there.
We hammered stones.
We chiseled wood.
We mended clothes.
We plastered holes.
We wrote.
We fought against AIDS.
We composed.
We fought against AIDS.
We slept there. We defecated there. We urinated there.
We ate there.
We bled. We broke bones. We vomited. We plucked our wine. We picked our noses.
We smoked.
We wiped our asses.
On life
we clipped our toenails.
We were satisfied.
We talked there.
We talked there.
We argued there.
We complained.
We conversed.
We slept there. We listened. We made love
there. We argued.
We talked. We listened.
We
understood.
We sympathized.
We harmonized.
We laughed.
We were renewed there.
We suffered in silence there.
We bragged about ourselves there.
We boasted.
We triumphed.
We bragged about ourselves.
We had dreams.
We brought down there.
We triumphed.
We shamed.
We
celebrated.
We hid from ourselves there.
We were brought down there.
We argued.
We were shamed there.
We fought our battles.
We hid from ourselves there.
We gave up on each other.
We gave up on ourselves.
We gave up on each other.
We lost hope.
We lost all.
We grieved.
We cried.
We wept.
We hurt.
We regretted being there.
We hid from one another.
We lost all.
Our bodies shrank there. We sat there, we rocked,
we hid from one another there. Our bodies shrank there.
We took stock, we worried, we rocked. Prayed, we assessed, we rejoiced.
Our eyesight dimmed.
We took stock.
We wondered.
We worried.
We contemplated the infinite.
We assessed.
We reflected
on our strengths. Our eyesight dimmed. Our minds dulled.
We worried.
We wondered.
We prayed.
We reflected.
We saw peace.
We prayed.
We embraced.
We begged forgiveness. We accepted what would come.
Sported here. have roared and swelled since days of old lang syne. For old lang syne. For old lang syne. But the grave between us roared and swelled since old lang syne. So take my hand, my trusted friend, and give me a hand of thine. We'll take a cup of drunkenness, our old anxiety. For old anxiety. For old anxiety. We'll take a cup of
good afternoon. I'm so glad to be here with all of you. My name is Alex Ates, and Maureen Shea was a teacher, director, and mentor to me. As a quick aside, I relay love and condolences from my friends Emma Barr Bittman and Jeff Freeman, who couldn't be here today, but whom I saw earlier this week. Jeff and Emma met in Maureen's directing class 10 years ago. Their romance I observed firsthand. And about 2 months ago, they welcome their son, Max. And if you want to see photos of Max, find me afterwards at the reception. As we reflect on Maureen's life, impact, and practice as an educator and artist, I am struck and frankly stuck, and after that performance, stunned, by the profoundness of Maureen's force. How with words can someone describe, truly describe, a mountain? Such is the challenge of memorializing Maureen. And so I will simply break it into beats. I will score it out and share some lessons with you that Maureen, my teacher, shared with me. I've assembled and sorted these lessons after harvesting my notebooks, emails, and scribblings in the margins of scripts. So here we go. The first lesson that Maureen taught us was that heightened stories, lives, and circumstances are attainable through the tools of symbolism, naturalism, and poetry. Such is the potential of the expressive arts, and hence Emerson. The second lesson is that, the second lesson is one that Maureen taught me after her stunning tribute to the beloved Bob Colby on this stage in 2021. Eulogies are conversations, and so if I feel nervous, flummoxed, or lost, I just need to settle into the conversation we're having with each other about our love for Maureen. The second lesson, of course, not only applies to memorials, plays are also conversations. The theater is a meeting house for conversation. That was the third lesson Maureen taught me. Even in grand cathedrals of theater, such as the Majestic, what makes this theater and any theater reverent and relevant is that it is a palace for meeting. meeting yourself, meeting ideas, hopes, and most prerequisitely, meeting each other. Theater is about the life around you, this Maureen insisted on. The fourth lesson Maureen taught me is that because theater is a meeting house, we must always, quote, give characters the dignity of being real. Poetic humanism, or humanism as poetry, made Maureen a great director and a spirit-led teacher. Quote, I want people in a room, not actors on a stage, she would say. Theater as conversation was not a way of simplifying the making of theater, but it was a deeper calling that required more listening from us artists. Maureen demanded this sort of deep listening and awareness when we collaborated, and she taught it into us so we could use it as a fixed point of truth once we left Emerson's boutique square block. Before we have anything to say, we must listen to the world around us, Maureen taught. A fifth lesson I learned when when Maureen was my director in Horton Foote's wistful play, The Actor. As a student actor, I was fearful of the titular role's vulnerability. Fear is the primary component of any actor's life, Maureen would counsel. Casting is a vote of confidence, she would assure. I'm here for you, I will catch you, she'd say. But you have to jump off the edge. Sentimentality and self-consciousness are the enemies of all art. She would go on, by being in the room, you're telling me you want to do it, so do it. Can't you just hear Maureen's intonation in that one? Can't you just see her eyes making contact with yours and that clever smile crescenting along her face? Sixth, Maureen provided a valuable resource to Emerson, an increasingly rare resource that's necessary for any theater school. Maureen provided honest critiques. As higher education is increasingly scrutinized, sanitized, and branded, Maureen was unabashed and brave in offering her assessment of the longitude and latitude of a student. She was unintimidated in giving the gift of uncushioned honesty. This tendency was made all the more radical as she operated in traditionally male-dominated spaces. Maureen's gusto was a gift. Her antennae for casting were never cliché, status quo, or safe. She had an affinity for sniffing out the potential of misfits, wallflowers, wounded warriors, backbenchers, and enigmas. Those who navigated her honesty walked away as more capable and more confident. Seventh, Maureen taught me to work on a play like a potter works on a wheel. Charge, carve, pound, push, and wrestle the play as you would earthy clay. Get it under your fingernails. Slap it, pinch it up, crush it down, cradle it, throw it on the table, and finesse its lines. Plays are not delicate ships in a bottle. They're materials of dust and dirt because they're matters of humans. Plays are containers of energy and space. The more you fight, dance, and submit to the play, the more energy it will contain. An eighth lesson was that although plays are poems and theaters are meeting houses, the seriousness of a theater artist should never eliminate one's capacity to be absurd, mischievous, or wicked. Maureen taught us to pivot between intense flows of highly caffeinated focus to boisterous, giddy, goofy guffaws. I recall when Maureen taught the company of the Grapes of Wrath to sing a profane shanty of complaints during a particularly long tech hold. Imagine it, in the Simmel Theater, an ensemble of college actors singing in harmony, profanity after profanity, in the round. It was sardonic, offensive, unprofessional, and oh, so delightful. A ninth lesson Maureen taught me is that I can't stomach fried clams. She was excited to take me to one of her favorite Bayside shacks to eat them. I turned green, and to this day, even the thought of them gives me the heebie-jeebies. A tenth lesson is that my parents and godparents love Maureen Shea. She got dinner with them at that Malaysian restaurant one block over from here. Maureen described my family as, quote, wonderfully eccentric and yet so normal. I agree with that description. My dad, an introvert by disposition, flowered in Maureen's presence. My godmothers, both queer elders, were enchanted by a unique camaraderie. The lesson here is that We carry our iterations in all of our interactions. The same thing that made me comfortable around Maureen is what made my family comfortable around her too. The 11th lesson is about those aforementioned iterations, the incarnations of our ancestors in our gut. During a tech rehearsal for a main stage show, Maureen stood up, left the room, and turned a play over to me, her assistant, so she could be with her dying mother. In choosing between being with her play and being with her mother in their final hours, Maureen made the right choice. Paradoxically, when she left, she pulled us closer together. "You will always be next to me as you were during one of the most profound times in my life," she wrote to me years later, reflecting on the episode. By leaving the room, Maureen did the right thing. "Plays are poems," she taught. "Quote, listen to the play like you listen to the people you love," she said. Yet, life is the essential, necessary, and permanent poetry. Plays are metaphors for love. Life is the real thing. Don't confuse the two. 12th lesson, Remington's and old meat and potatoes. Dive bar where the new Emerson dining hall sits now was a memorable place to conduct independent studies in the afternoon. Who can forget drinking a Guinness, smelling the stale wooden furniture, discussing Shakespeare, realizing a mouse was climbing over your foot, and then slipping out into the night of day, or the light of day. The 13th lesson is a regret. I wish I had gone bowling with Maureen. I don't even know if she liked bowling, but if you'll validate my imagination, I'd like to envision Maureen as a proficient candlepin bowler, Massachusetts icon that she is. In addition to being a potter, Maureen, when directing, was a bowler. In the rehearsal hall, she would charge the play as a bowling ball charges pins. When all the pins crashed, the sound was glorious, and it was a small miracle in its way. When a gutter ball was thrown, it met the gutter with the same sheer force as it would the pins. Then, a roar, a laugh, a snap, a stomp, unhideable failure. And then to the next roll, a new frame, a new game. 14th, taking Mirta's ways of seeing class and Maureen's languages of the stage in my first semester at Emerson was an indelible 1-2 inducement into ways of seeing the worlds of the plays. In my first year, Maureen and Mirta woke up the artist in me. 15th and finally, a wonderful lesson, revel in the life of the theater maker. Be grateful for the lives of the stage she taught, and hold urgent to the wisdom of plays. After Emerson, Maureen and I corresponded about many plays. In recent years, we returned often to Thornton Wilder's mystical Our Town. Quote, "The play encompasses all that is joyful and painful in life," Maureen wrote, "as if our contribution to the universe as human beings is emotion and anxiety. Feelings both joyful and painful, feelings that go with both community and isolation, life and death." Maureen wrote that to me on March 11th, 2020, right before the pandemic shutdowns. Maureen went on, "What's that beautiful line from the gorgeous poem by Wendell Berry, The Peace of Wild Things? I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with the forethought of grief." Maureen continued, "Our Town for me captures that difference between humans and wild things, not that peace, but rather the fact that we live each day with the forethought of grief." Or as Emily from Our Town maintains, "We should live so that we can live. We should live so that we can truly live." For Maureen, the words live and love were identical twins, if not interchangeable ones. This is the Mo Shea Manifesto. When we dignify stories on stage, we express our love for life in stubborn defiance of grief. Maureen mastered that and dedicated her life to teach it to us all. Thank you, for that last lesson, Maureen. That last note, that last direction. Thank you.
I always saw Maureen as the St. Peter of the Performing Arts Department, standing before the Semmel's pearly gates, ready to destroy any preconceived notions you may have about the theater. And I feel so sorry for all the bright-eyed freshmen who are going to come into this institution and we'll never get to see Maureen Shea standing there with Magritte's The Treachery of Images projected behind her. From the first time I heard her speak, I made working with her my one goal during my time at Emerson. In 2016, Maureen and Mirta took a handful of students to Barcelona for the Grec Theater Festival, and I had the immense privilege of joining them. It was in that otherworldly city that I fell in love with them. I was already starstruck by their art and insights, but in spending that month with them, day in and day out, laughing, crying, drinking, they became my friends. And that was the greatest gift I'd ever been given. I can remember so distinctly sitting with Maureen in the Abbey of Montserrat. A Catalonian organist was playing the most gorgeous ecclesiastic music I'd ever heard. We were sitting in one of the back pews, and much like right now, I started bawling. And I turned and saw that she was too. That kind of intimacy with a teacher was not something I was used to. But it meant the world to me that she felt safe enough to show herself fully to me. And we often cried together. Her passion was infectious. Nobody could move me with words like she did. Among her considerable talents, she was a consummate poet. Maureen was exceptional, truly the most intelligent and nuanced individual I ever had the opportunity of knowing. The sheer fact that I've been asked to come here today and speak to her memory is almost more than I can bear. I always assumed she just tolerated me. that she found me vaguely amusing or that I understood her references and could hold a conversation slightly. But I felt such a kindred spirit with her. We were both loud and proud, but I think we both saw in each other the shy, sensitive, indeed wounded souls we donned beneath the armor. She was so soft with me, so generous and sweet. But what a remarkable wit, too. I mean, she was never without a zinger. I remember on that trip to Barcelona, we met in the Picasso Museum. I met with her there after a night of heavy drinking. And she looked at me up and down and without missing a beat with that incomparable gruffness, said, "Morning, Elliot, you look like 40 miles of bad road." And naturally, I had to crack out the inhaler. I mean, she was positively Falstaffian. She had such energy and presence. And it is a testament to her gravitas that we hold this memorial here in the Cutler Majestic, the finest theater we have in the city and one on which the students of this institution have the privilege of treading its boards each year. And she was noble. Noble in the way only someone who takes up the vocation of teaching can be. to guide, not to dictate young minds. Something much easier said than done, as students tend to believe they know everything and teachers tend to believe they've seen everything. Teachers also, it should be noted, bear witness to their students' lives, their failures, their successes, their pain, and their joy. Maureen bore witness to my life at its most painful and confusing. I was going into my senior year feeling rudderless, deeply insecure about my work as an actor, and terrified as I was watching my father slowly die of addiction. I can say wholeheartedly that Maureen got me through that year in one piece. She gave me a chance to work with her, and I took her up on that offer. We spent 6 months on a production of Getting Out by Marsha Norman, and at the end of that run, I held her close, and it seemed as if all the trauma of that year dissipated in that moment. And in that moment, I knew that I had found my mentor, that person everyone talks about in college, the teacher that changed everything. I love Maureen, and I wish I had the opportunity to tell her just how much she meant to me, how much her work meant to me, how much her sheer existence meant to me. And I will spend the rest of my life trying to live in the lamplight of her example. I'd like to close out my time today with an excerpt from Maria Irene Fornes's play, Fefu and Her Friends, the first production I saw at Emerson, and I'd argue one of the crown jewels in Maureen's theatrical oeuvre. We will seize all, learn all, know all here, that we may fare further on the great quest. The task of now is only a step toward the task of the whole. Let us then seek the laws governing real life forces that, coming into their own, they may create, develop, and reconstruct. Let us awaken life dormant. Let us boldly, seizing the star of our intent, lift it as a lantern of our necessity, and let it shine over the darkness of our compliance. Come. The light shines. Come. It brightens our way. Come. Don't let its glorious light pass you by. Come. The day has come. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Ken Cheeseman. Nobody's said it yet, but that is an amazing photograph, isn't it? They got it. They got it. They got the glint in the eye, the smile, the little bit of, I'm going to make some good trouble. Do you see it? And they caught it in a moment, one fraction of a second, one moment. This is something Maureen and I talked about all the time. The narrative, the story, like in visual media arts, 24 frames per second, 24 of these little tiny frames, and you string them together and all of a sudden you have a narrative. You have a life. That's what we were in conversation about. I agree with what Maureen said, thank you, Alex, that a eulogy is a conversation. If you will allow me, and I feel like so many others today, so honored to have the opportunity to speak. Mirta, I hope you don't regret it because you've put the fool clown here, but I feel like Maureen, how else could it be that you have a fool or a clown? So my conversation is really with Maureen, and I'm just hoping that when I'm done, she's still smiling. Oh, shit, Maureen. We were like the Providence and Worcester Railroad. We were like a straight, direct line between our origins, industrious, hardworking cities, best defined by their mayors. Worcester's mayor, Phineas Ball. Somebody might know who that was. His tough, no-nonsense approach to governing was the origin of the expression, "You've got a lot of balls." That's Phineas Ball. That's where that came from. You didn't know that, did you? I will bet that Maureen did. Didn't you know that? You probably did. Now, Providence, my city of origin, had Buddy Cianci. He could put a cigarette out in a man's eye, but he bailed out Trinity Repertory Company and sold them their theater for a dollar. These were cities with folks willing to dig in the dirt, get their hands dirty, to sit in the shit, pardon my French, and then to stand up and turn it to gold. Cities that honored their institutions of higher education and the arts, because for many of us, that was our salvation. That's how we survived, right, Maureen? Those cities, they were in our blood, they were in our DNA. Hey, Maureen. Not bad for a couple of scrappy kids from Worcester and Providence. Huh? Look at this. We had bonded early on, Brimmer Street, where theater was started in a fireplace, a rough ragtag space filled with found objects, old candy wrappers, blood, sweat, and tear-stained furniture. And it was Maureen who hired me, who cast me in an ensemble of artist teachers to whom she mandated that we have a relentless focus on one thing, creating a genuine, deep, practical, memorable, and valuable experience for the students. As in all friendships, there was one defining moment, one experience that encapsulates a relationship. You probably all have one. And as you look at that glint in her eye, you probably had your own special thing with Maureen. With us, it was a kind of secret undercurrent, a private understanding. Sometimes it was just with a look, maybe a wink or a nod. It was always there between us. And I doubt that many of you caught it in our faculty meetings. Maybe you did in gatherings, at theater openings, but we always had this kind of direct, steely glint in our eyes, like that railway from Providence to Worcester, like, I know where you're at, Maureen. Oh, shit, Maureen, I'm gonna tell them what it was. So about 20 years ago, we just moved into the Tufte, and I somehow got word that Maureen needed to see me as soon as possible in her office. And there was an unusual sense of urgency to this request. I walked into Maureen's office and she said conspiratorially, "Close the door." She looked at me with a wincing glance. I sat down with a furrowed brow of concern. She released a sigh. Oh. A sigh Kristen Linkletter would have acknowledged as a deep down, true blue, genuinely felt sigh of preferably pleasurable relief. This was big. I didn't know then, I know it now, but this was the moment that would forever shape our relationship. And so she began. "I'm completely overwhelmed," she said. She had only just been released from the hospital. She had been dealing with these health issues for some time, and she was already right back at her desk. "My back is up against the wall," she said, and that's the only reason I need someone to do this. Otherwise, you know, I would have done it myself. "You're the only person I could think of who could do this for me, the only one I could trust." "Oh. Of course, Maureen, anything you need," I said.
I need you to deliver something. You can say no if this is too much, if it feels wrong in any way. I could probably hire somebody to do this if I needed to, but I just can't do it myself. Well, what is it, Maureen? She reached down and she placed a small brown paper bag on the desk in front of her and she stared at it gravely. This needs to be dropped off by noon, she said. All the way on the other side of town. Maybe you could ride your bike there. It's critical it gets there before noon, while it's still fresh. Fresh, I thought? Where does it need to be, Maureen? It needs to be delivered to Mass General Hospital by noon. It's a stool sample. Our eyes froze in a timeless dimension. It was everything, everywhere, all at once. We were riding that Worcester-Providence Railroad in a bullet train. Ever so slowly, our eyes sparkled and our mouths turned into wry little smiles. And I said, you want me to take your shit, Maureen? Yes, I want you to take my shit. We burst into uproarious laughter that rapidly morphed into an Arlecchino La Signora Commedia shitlotzi. Holy shit! Oh, it's a lot of shit. So we're deep in this shit? I am so sick of this shit. This shit stinks. I gotta get rid of this shit. It's a load of shit to carry. I hate to give you a ration of shit. Don't worry, Maureen. I'm tough. I can take a lot of shit. Yeah, I've seen you take a load of crap. So I figured you could do it. I'm sure this won't be the last time I'll have to take your shit. Well, I've had to put up with your shit. If you dole it out, you gotta be able to take it. Thanks for putting up with my shit. What can I say, Maureen? I'm gonna drop the shit. And off I went on my bicycle, carrying Maureen's shit. Shit that was turned into a golden friendship. So if ever any of you caught one of those oh shit looks between Maureen and me, that is exactly what it was. We had each other's shit, even though long ago we had dropped the shit. Oh God, I love you, Maureen. Ah, shit. You're still smiling. All right.
Hi there. I'm Scott Wheeler. I think there was only one year that Maureen directed the Emerson Spring Musical. She and I did a Kurt Weill review called From Berlin to Broadway. It was one of the years the Majestic was unavailable, so we rehearsed and performed in the Fireplace Theater at Brimmer Street. I played piano, leading the tiny ensemble we could fit into that space. Maureen, of course, knew a ton about music, so she was completely comfortable directing a show that was mostly singing. She would come into rehearsal with a plan, then improvise, then change her mind, all with complete authority and ease. At one point, Maureen confided to me that she was struggling to find a way to stage the ending of our show. Finally, her idea was to have the whole cast process in two lines, which met to form couples. She said to me, "Two people come together on stage. What could be more dramatic than that?" Somehow that simple idea was heart-stopping. Perhaps my favorite staging moment in all the shows I've done at Emerson. When I saw it, I realized the artistic power of this person I was so lucky to be working with. So, when I was invited to play for today's sad celebration, I decided to compose an intermezzo, a sort of meditation on one of the great songs from that show that we did. This is the title song from Kurt Weill's musical, Lost in the Stars, in memory of our wonderful friend, Maureen.
Goodness gracious, putting me after the virtuosity of Scott Wheeler is wild. Hi, I'm Misha, and not to brag, but I am a proud disciple of Maureen Shea. I graduated nearly 8 years ago, and I'm still living in accordance to the code of honor of the Shea. I'm honored to be here today, like so many others have just said. And I think the venue's nice. But it's not, honestly, it's not quite grand enough or sparkly enough or historied enough for Maureen, for our king. The first thing I did when I heard that this was happening today, I promise this won't be all about me, but I went faster than the speed of light to jetblue.com, and I said, I have to be on a plane immediately. And the second thing I did was I nominated myself to speak. I sent someone whose entire self is kind of built on being careful and not wanting to offend or push too hard, I sent a rather forward email in response to Mirta saying, I'd like to speak. And it was almost as if Maureen Shea was giving me a line reading herself. I'd like to speak. And for those of you who don't know, Maureen is famous for line readings. That means a director will give an actor essentially a complete sense of how to say a line, the scansion, the clarity, the intonation. Not tons of room for interpretation there. So she gave line readings, and she didn't really care whether or not that was something that other people agreed with. And I felt very Maureen in that moment with her line reading in my ear. I'd like to speak. Later, I found out that I did miss some Facebook messages from important people asking me to be here, so I'm happy about that. But, you know, Maureen, she taught me a lot of things, but one of them that was my favorite, and just like those before me have referenced, with a little mischievousness in her eye, she did not really care to be everyone's cup of tea. It just wasn't in her values. And that's not to be understated. Like, do you understand how amazing that is? As women, all we're taught, if you're socialized as a woman, the only thing we're taught to do is be the most universally consumable cup of tea possible. And Maureen was like, no, I'm fine. And at 18 years old, encountering that was a paradigm shift. And that sounds a little hyperbolic, perhaps, but it's not. She shifted the way that so many of us saw ourselves and how we see the world and who we are and how we are able to step into that. I was talking to some students, and one of them, Rihanna Dunn, who's watching from LA today, said that she nailed down something about my own queerness for me that I just hadn't been able to before. And Danielle Pointer, who's another alum here in the audience, she flew today also from Los Angeles, said she was the first director to cast me not to meet a quota of one of the few brown girls in the cast. She made space for my full humanity. And Gigi Watson, who's here today, another beloved alum, said she just kind of walked around waking people up. That was what Gigi did. And I think that's true. I'm gonna sip some water. When I talk about things I care about this much, it's like the dry. I think that those of us who were lucky enough to kind of reside under Maureen's wing for a time were chosen for a reason, and not because we are smarter, more talented, better, none of that. It's because we're strange and we needed what she had to offer. She knew she had a sniffer and she could be of service to certain students in the sense that we needed a mixture of like an existential hug and kind of a jolt of electricity and a kick in the pants to not be so schmaltzy about it. Like, she's like, I get it, you're different, you're weird, it's hard. But if you work hard, guess what, you'll survive. So I was in a rehearsal of hers, and at the end of the rehearsal, she said, all right, Misha Lambert, have you ever turned on a lamp before? Doesn't seem like it. All right, next. And what she was covering there is actually so deep, because the reason I looked insane trying to turn on a lamp is because I was self-conscious and I didn't want my body to be seen, and I was feeling kooky and felt eyes on me, and she just said, turn on a lamp. Turn on a lamp. And she gave us these life rafts, and that was one, that if you work hard, you will float. She also gave another one that has been mentioned today that It just blew me away. She would tell insane stories, as you've heard. There was one about twins and a log cabin and like shotguns. I can't get into it right now. But it was horrifying. It was scary beyond measure. And she just bellowed at absurdity. She bellowed at horrific tales of life and death. And it woke something up in me that, oh, right, life is amusing. And that hard work thing meant to me that life is important. And she created these hermetically sealed bubbles where learning could happen and insight could happen and magic and playfulness could happen. I just don't know how she did that. I'd like to think, presumptuous perhaps, that maybe she saw a little bit of herself in me and perhaps me in her. She saw someone who's not small and who is not normal and who is not straight and who is not able-bodied or particularly well. She saw someone who she decided to say, come with me too. And that's quite an honor from the paradigm shifter. I just want to end with one little lore, and it's something I'm not sure has been spoken aloud. That woman would cast her shows, I think it was on a subconscious level, so calm down. This is not because she said, did, or insinuated anything on the subject, but she would cast the queer people, the ones who either were queer and didn't know it, were queer and were on the precipice of kind of stepping into themselves, or were queer and needed to be like completely radicalized into full like freaks, you know? And she would just cast us with these 7-month long rehearsal processes, which Broadway could not fund. So I have no idea how she got away with that. And by the end of the process, we were all ourselves. I mean, it's unreal. It's truly unreal. So I'll conclude with saying that I've been Maureen'd, you know? I've been thoroughly Maureen'd. I'm more myself. I'm darker, lighter, weirder, smarter. I work harder. And I've been left better than I was found. And if you're here in the audience today, if you're watching from wherever you are, you've been Maureen too, whether you liked it or not. So I want to say to her, thanks for Maureening me. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Melia Bensusan. I'm going to put on my glasses for a minute and then I'll take them off. It's really nice to be home. I was a faculty member here. I am a faculty member here for 22 years and was chair after Maureen Shea. So I am the last speaker, and that is, well, Amelia will conclude, but I will say it is both a privilege and a curse because I'm following all these brilliant words. So I said, we'll see. I feel like Maureen was back there with me listening. She has some notes. All right. I'm one of the worst impersonators, but fuck, I miss her. She was a woman taker for all in all. I shall not look upon her like again. She's been with me all day since she died. She's been more with me. I'm incredibly lucky. I knew Maureen through what I will call chapters. I'm going to keep this brief, I swear to you. Our first meeting was 23 years ago, almost to the day. I was here interviewing to run M Stage because Maureen had just been made chair and she thought maybe running M Stage and being chair was just a little too much. I got to hang out with Maureen Shea and Rhea Gaisner and I thought, fuck, will they take me here? I would love to work here. Then they offered me a job, thank you, Grafton. And they were offering me the same salary I was making at SMU in Dallas, a much cheaper city to live in. Now, I don't have a terminal degree. This was a matter of much discussion. And when I called Maureen to say, couldn't I make just a little more? Boston's expensive, I hear. Maureen said, no. And then she said, I can't even read my fucking notes, okay. She said, and I can't do her accent, all right? I'm like a shtetl Jew from Mexico. We don't do Worcester. But she said, come on, Melia, you're going to come. You don't want your kids to grow up with Texas accents, do you? So that was it. She said something also about, you're in Dallas, right? Aren't you tired of living in a mall? So, you know. We talked plays all the time. We exchanged titles and ideas. We didn't take each other's ideas. We took each other's titles. Her SDC membership meant so much to, I'm making a mess up here. I'm sorry, I'm really verklempt. She loved being an SDC member. I just want to say to the universe, we honored her at an SDC meeting, which was very special. And I'm going to say this lovingly, and I dare any of you to disagree. No one could make a play longer than Maureen Shea. Somewhere, there's that production of Hamlet that she and Bob Colby co-directed. It's still going. Right? And fucking Much Ado, that was like two plays. Because she loved it so much. I mean, she couldn't cut a word of Shakespeare, A, and B, Much Ado needed like a whole poetry play in the transitions, remember? And you gotta love it. It's because there were voices, there were students who she wanted to hear and poems she wanted said. It was prodigious, and yes, Falstaffian. Someone's already stolen that. We'll deal with that later. The next chapter of my life with Maureen was infinitely harder. When I was made interim chair, I could say that we argued a lot, but that would not be accurate. What is accurate is that she yelled at me a lot. A lot. Mary Harkins, Mary Ellen, Jason Susana, Eric Weiss got me through and kept our friendship, kept mine and Maureen's friendship. And Mary Ellen, you're right. It wasn't rage, it was fire. She was terrified I was gonna mess up. All right, she was terrified I was gonna fuck up all her work that she had done for this department. There would be long emails that I would respond to in one way, and she would storm down that hall and come into the office. Sometimes I pretended I wasn't in the office and I'd close the door, and I would hear her talk to Jason, and Jason would be wonderful, and Maureen loved Jay, and Jay loved Maureen, and I would hide. But we got through that. We got through growing pains. And then it was like being accepted at the grown-ups table. I know you know what I mean. She was like a grown-up intellectually. The last time I saw Maureen was almost exactly a year ago, something about March, and the Ides of it, so forth, right? We met for a catch-up for Bloody Marys. We drank a lot of Bloody Marys together, and I always paid the check. I was always grateful. It started 23 years ago, you know, it's just a lot of Bloody Marys. We had probably about three Bloody Marys each. This was March of 2022, right? It's 2023, God knows. She looked great. She was wearing those glasses, and I was like, you wear glasses? She was like, no, they just look good. And I was like, yeah, they do. Mirta querida, hablamos de ti. Hablamos completamente de ti. Porque estaba preocupada de ti y te quiere tanto, bueno, tú sabes cuánto que te quiere. Pero te adoraba y estaba preocupada. She was planning to retire in December of 2022. That's what we were meeting about. She was done. She wanted to be in Barcelona with Mirta. Enough. Man plans, God laughs. Being here to... Being here today, I can just say it's impossible to follow in Maureen's footsteps. If you've ever received a lengthy email from her or read her faculty reviews, you know. I have never met anyone who had the right word at the right time and could describe anyone in any moment so succinctly and so wittily. You'd first laugh and then you'd think about it for months and for years later how perfectly she'd summed you up. There's not an Emerson email that comes now that I don't think, oh shit, I need to send this to Maureen so we can kibitz. Not a bit of theater news that we couldn't email each other briefly with a snarky note attached. Two-line emails, three-line emails. And truly often I'd send her something just to get her caustic reply, because full disclosure, I have often used her lines as my own. I have plagiarized Dr. Maureen Shea for 23 years. And so, at this moment, I will continue that tradition, and I'm just gonna share some of the later emails I received from Maureen. We had a growing shtick about, you know, being Jews and Catholics. You can figure out who was who. So, one particular exchange, and I'm just putting her parts here, so I'm linking them, so it's clumsier than she would have written it, so bear with me. Catholic in Worcester. First communion at age 7, let's all eat his body and drink his blood, and then they give us a juice box. Then confirmation. I took the name Jude because of the Beatles, and then found out he was the patron saint of hopeless cases. Stayed with the name just to irk my parents. An email sent from Tech during the first Zoom theater performance in performing arts. This is all she sent me. Ready? Sarah Hickler, it's for you. A men on boats haiku. The canary in the coal mine. Gasp, gasp, thud. Don't come in. Then an email about January 6th. The storming of the Capitol, of the storming of my innards on the same day. She'd had major surgery that day. The storming of the Capitol and the storming of my innards. I mean, come on. All right, this is the longer one. I'm almost done. I just want you to hear this one. This was just from last May. My old buddy and office mate at Virginia Tech, the brilliant theater management consultant George Thorne. I mean, how many of us heard George Thorne stories? I mean, it was a big part of her life at Virginia Tech. So one year, we had a lull in our office, and we embroidered for many years. It was kind of like fantasy football, called the worst theater company. He was tired of mission statements and said the company was going to create quality theater. So our mission was to make the worst theater possible. We even made up real letterhead. I recall the masks of tragedy and comedy flanking the quote, "The theater has no back door." Herbert Blau was our first artistic director. Look it up, those of you who've never heard of Herbert Blau. And it got worse after that. We had a resident acting company, many film actors for the draw, like Nicolas Cage and James Franco, and an artistic staff. Managers, anyone from the roundabout, a board, etc. George would add names as he came back from consulting gigs on the road. I need to tell him who I've added to the roster. Yeah. Be afraid. That's the right response. And after an Emerson meeting where nothing was resolved, she sent me this. None of us knows what lies ahead, of course, but then we're pretty good at staring into the abyss and coming up with something. My money's on us. In Jewish tradition, when someone passes, as Rob Sabal so beautifully said, we say, may their memory be a blessing. Well, Maureen, you got that so fucking right. Your memory infuses generations of students, colleagues, friends to be honest, to be smart, to care passionately about theater and about other people, and to rage against the dying of the light. I am blessed to carry your voice within me. Thank you all.
Don't you love us? I love us. I love us, Maureen. Couple more things for us before we adjourn. I'm Amelia, Chair of Performing Arts at this moment. I have some words from Maureen's sister Kathleen that I'd like to read to you. It's entitled, Remembering Maureen. How do I best describe Maureen? According to Emerson Today, September 22, 2022, her friends and colleagues recalled a passionate, larger-than-life presence who had a wicked sense of humor, was irreverent, funny, generous, loving, a great storyteller, hard-headed, and a force of nature. Although I share these impressions, I would have to add that she was also a devoted daughter to my mom and dad, an avid competitor in card games and Scrabble, a lover of any and all kinds of music, director of our favorite childhood pastime of putting on shows, and an expert at choosing the best children's books for her nieces, the kinds they always wanted to hear over and over, especially when she came to visit. Her first faculty position was at Virginia Tech. While there, Maureen spent summers directing musicals at the Jenny Wiley Theater in Prestonsburg, Kentucky, and won national acclaim from the American College Theater Festival, where her production of How I Got That Story was performed at the Kennedy Center. In 1988, she moved to Emerson, where she spent the remainder of her career, beginning as the producing artistic director of Emerson Stage and serving two stints as department chair, bookends of sorts, to her 35-plus years there. She directed 24 productions for Emerson Stage and freelance works in many places, both in the United States and overseas, but never lost her enthusiasm for her work, her willingness to try new things, and her pleasure at seeing her students succeed while at Emerson and after graduation. As a high school English teacher, I was fortunate to have Maureen as my mentor, a sounding board, and as a friend. I taught many of Shakespeare's less studied works for high schools in my years as part of the Cambridge English program, encountering new challenges each semester. Maureen, being the Shakespeare expert that she was, offered me plenty of background material and new ideas and insights that she knew would help me to get my students motivated. My memories of long conversations about Richard III, a play she had just completed, hold a special place for me as I struggled through the challenging material. Over the years, I enviously listened in on summer Shakespeare classes she offered to high school teachers, wishing I had the opportunity to participate. Her final classes at Emerson were some of these. Ironically, the last time I heard Maureen speak publicly was in September 2022 on a video she sent me of the Celebration of Life gathering for Bob Colby, and almost a year to the date before she passed away. Maureen and Bob were familiar figures on the Emerson campus. He had worked at Emerson for 44 years and Maureen for over 40. In the span of these years, they became great friends and colleagues. Years ago, they had co-directed a musical adaptation of A Tale of Two Cities, and Maureen had seen every show Bob directed while he was at Emerson. He had preceded her as department chair before his death, and once again, Maureen took over the position as co-chair along with Amelia Broom. "He was an amazing human being, our Bob," wrote Maureen. I say our because he truly belonged to us, just as we were his. Bob was devoted to performing arts, and so was she. Maureen was fortunate to follow her passion for art, while at the same time influencing so many lives in different arenas. She had a strong sense of her mission at Emerson and stood up for her students, her colleagues, her causes, and her principles. She was tough, but that made her so good. She leaves behind a legacy that will be difficult for others to follow. Maureen, I am so proud of the choices you have made. May you rest in peace. Thank you all for being here today to celebrate our Maureen Shea. There's a reception at the Simmel Theater directly following this event. There's a book that you could write remembrances in. It's in the Simmel lobby. Thank you again, and thank you, our Maureen.
Spaces, what are we living for? Abandoned places, I guess we know the score. On and on, does anybody know what we are looking for? Another hero, another mindless crime behind the curtain. Tales of yesterday.